Пошлите поможем, может, раненые какие-то. Еба. Ебать, могли нас въебать. Просто пизда, вот сейчас за нами ехали. За нами ехали, пацаны. Вон лежат раненые, есть. Ебать. Ебать, там горит кто-то в ней. Ебать! Ебать, там пацаны горят. Пошлите поможем, может, раненые какие-то. Ебать! Ебать, могли нас въебать! Вот сейчас за нами ехали. За нами ехали, пацаны. Вон лежат раненые, есть. Ебать. Ебать, там горит кто-то в ней. Ебать, там пацаны горят.
The Russian propaganda reporter Resource writes about the possible liberation of Belarus by Ukrainian troops. The publication named several reasons why Kyiv might consider this step. They include an attempt to get NATO countries to join the war, strengthening of negotiating positions, and elimination of the threat of a repeated Russian offensive against Kyiv. According to sources cited by the Ukrainian National Resistance Center, members of Belarus's security services privately acknowledge that their military lacks the strength and resources to engage in combat against Ukraine. It is also noted that Belarus has transferred a significant portion of its Soviet-era weaponry and ammunition to Russia. The military and political leadership of Belarus is hesitant to participate in the war against Ukraine, recognizing that their troops would be incapable of standing up to the Ukrainian Armed Forces, reported National Resistance Center, which relays these insights based on its sources. In informal discussions, Belarusian security officials have admitted that their military is ill-equipped to fight Ukraine. The situation is exacerbated by Belarus having handed over much of its Soviet-era arsenal to Russia. Additionally, the Belarusian military lacks experience in modern warfare, heightening the unwillingness among personnel to engage in combat against Ukraine's defense forces. The Ukrainian operations in the Kursk region have also had an impact. There are direct parallels drawn between the Belarusian armed forces and Russian units that were securing the border in that region during off-the-record conversations. Belarusians are also concerned about their oil refineries taking a cue from how Ukraine has been striking Russian refineries with drones, which Russia has been unable to defend. They are acutely aware that Ukrainian missiles and drones can strike them, and Belarusian air defenses lack combat experience. Given that Russian air defenses have failed to protect their own refineries from Ukraine's defense forces, it's clear Belarus would struggle even more, the National Resistance Center notes. Additionally, President of Lithuania has called for sanctions on Belarus, equating it with Russia due to its dangerous activities. Gitanas Noseda argues that Belarus's military exercises with Russia, provision of their territory for an offensive against Ukraine, and overall border destabilization necessitate stringent measures in response. Today, Russia is in a state of serious exhaustion. Putin's army is catastrophically short of equipment, so it uses it only in certain sections of the front. In particular in the area of Kurakovo and Ugledar, This was reported by the Ukrainian military political observer of the group Information Resistance, Alexander Kovalenko, on the air of the YouTube channel Govorit Veliki Lviv. According to the expert, Russian military equipment has not appeared in the Kursk region for almost a month. Only recently, when the Russians launched a counter-offensive in this direction, did they begin to use a mechanized component. But there is a very interesting point here. When they started using equipment, they immediately reduced the number of FPV drones and CABs. Because there is no stable line of combat, and they do not understand where their units are and where ours are, Kovalenko added. Reports and analytical materials have repeatedly appeared in the information space about how Russia is losing a large amount of equipment and cannot compensate for it every month in such quantities as to break even, the analyst said. According to Kovalenko, the Russians are now going into the minus, and North Korea and Iran will not help them restore their potential. They need a pause, peace talks, and a reduction in the intensity of military actions. The occupiers understand that if they begin to reduce the fire impact, a Ukrainian counteroffensive will immediately begin, and they need to make sure that it does not begin under any circumstances, the expert explained. As Russia's wider war on Ukraine grinds into its third year, three main dynamics are shaping the battlefield. First, Russia is fully mobilized, politically, industrially, and militarily. But this mobilization is depleting resources the Kremlin can't renew. Most importantly, stocks of old Cold War vintage weapons. In other words, Russia is strong but fragile. Second, Ukraine is mobilizing too, but it still relies on foreign aid to meet urgent financial and military needs, and Russia-friendly Republicans in the US House of Representatives are withholding a decisive portion of that aid. Third, Ukrainian tactics are superior to Russian tactics, helping Ukrainian formations to defeat much larger Russian formations. But tactics are irrelevant when and where Ukrainian forces simply run out of ammunition.